Hi everyone, it's Dr. A with some chemistry basics. We are going to look at just a few GI tests. So first let's talk about ulcer disease or peptic ulcer disease. Up to 10% of the U.S. population will develop ulcers at some point in their life. Helicobacter pylori has been identified as the cause of ulcer diseases. This is a bacteria that actually can survive the acidity of the stomach and can settle in the stomach and cause ulcers to develop. The transmission of this bacteria seems to be either via fecal-oral or oral-oral routes, and the prevalence does increase with age and correlates with poor sanitation. And then, of course, you can test for H. pylori, you can test for H. pylori antibodies, or if the physician chooses to go and explore the upper GI, they can take a biopsy of the ulcer and test for the presence of H. pylori. To obviously confirm the cause as a cause of peptic ulcer disease. Next, we have pseudomembranous colitis. It is an acute inflammation of the colon. The symptoms are profound diarrhea, urgency, and abdominal cramping. The diarrhea will have white blood cells in the stool, a positive test for occult blood in the stool, and elevated WBC count, a white cell count in the blood on the CBC. Non-infectious colitis will include ischemic colitis and drug-induced colitis, and then the infectious one is really, it's usually acquired nosocomially, so in the hospital as a result of the ingestion of C. difficile spores. Most patients are asymptomatic, and a lot of patients just carry a certain amount of C. difficile in their gut. Oftentimes, if they get treated with really potent antibiotics like vancomycin, it can destroy enough of the gut bacteria that C. difficile can take over and cause this pseudomembranous colitis and cause problems. So it is often seen also as a result of antibiotic therapy in hospitals. The diagnosis of C. difficile can be made from a patient's stool, and we can do it in several ways. We can detect the C. difficile toxin or antigen through the use of ELISA assays. A lot of times it will require a test. It don't take about 15 minutes to run. There are also now more newer PCR assays, GI panels and stuff that can test for C. diff and other pathogens all at once. And the more traditional way was to culture the organism with selective media and more traditional microbiology techniques. That is mostly outdated. There are very few labs that do it that way. They'll either do the quick a quick assay, or they'll do a PCR type of assay. Lastly, we have CEA, that's carcinoembryonic antigen. The normal range is less than 2.5 nanograms per mil for non-smokers, less than 5 nanograms per mil for smokers. CEA is an oncofetal antigen that is normally expressed in low levels in the GI mucosa, meaning CEAs are normally high in fetus, and then the other instances where we see elevated is oncology cancers, right? That's why it's oncofetal. So in the context of the GI tract, elevations in CEA levels are most often seen with colon cancer, although it may also be elevated in breast and lung cancers as well as other malignancies. This test is commonly used to assess and monitor patients with a known history of colon cancer. So it is not specifically diagnostic for colon cancer, but in the context of everything else that's going on with the patient, if the CEA levels are elevated and have been diagnosed with colon cancer, then the CEA can be used to assess how well therapy is going, how successful surgery was, and if there's any reoccurrence after maybe the surgery had removed everything. If for some reason it pops back up, then one of the ways to screen for it would be to run a CEA, especially if it was initially elevated. The levels should drop after surgery, but then if they come back up later, then that means the cancer's coming back. So anyway, so that's CEA in the context of the GI system. All right, that wraps up. Those were the three tests for the GI system.